Good morning. This is day two of our new series entitled What God is Doing Today. In John 17 verses 21 through 23 and John 14 verses 18 through 23. If you have time, okay, read these passages, because these are my favorite passages in the Bible. They both are telling us of the ultimate plan of God, which is to make man in His image and to dwell in man for eternity. Read them, okay? Even after we have done with our meditation. This great festivals of Israel tells us of the three platforms of redemption: giving back to God that which was stolen by Satan, that Christian people are to experience so that God's final purposes in them may be fulfilled. Three times a year, all your men must appear before the Lord, your God, at the place He will choose, at the Festival of Unleavened Bread, Festival of Weeks, and the Festival of Tabernacles. No one should appear before the Lord empty-handed, Deuteronomy 16:16. The Festival of Unleavened Bread is symbolic of basic salvation, which is the blood atonement, the removal of Antichrist's spirit of the world, and the born-again experience of the saints. The Festival of Weeks, which is symbolic of Pentecost. Okay? Then the third, the Festival of Tabernacles, is the symbolic of the final acts of redemption, the Christian Church. In some instances, I celebrated the first two gatherings. In the third gathering, Tabernacles is just beginning to be fulfilled in the days in which we are living. Tabernacles, as its name suggests, has to do with God's plan in creating man. It is the dwelling of God in man, and the dwelling of man in God. God desires a house and a home and a resting place and a location for His throne. Mankind has been created to fulfill God's desire. But Christ has the power to free us from all of this if we will confess our sins and self-will and do what He says. Such is part of the third platform of redemption. We can see this third platform in the following verses in John 14 verses 18 through 23. I will just read the last verse. Jesus replied, "Anyone who loves me will obey my teaching. My Father will love them, and we will come to them and make our home with them. Whoever has my commands and keeps them is the one who loves me." I marvel that those who are teaching that God has given us grace because we are unable to meet His demands cannot see that there are many passages in the New Testament pointing out to us that we show our love for Christ by actually doing what He commands. Our tendency seems to be to say, "Lord, Lord, how wonderful You are," and then not to do what He commands. How disappointing this must be to the Lord Jesus Christ. There are many today who attend church services so they can enjoy an emotional experience. I wonder in how many churches the written word is being expounded such that the believers go away with an understanding of how they are to behave. The one who loves me will be loved by my Father, and I too will love them and show myself to them. I believe it is clear from the New Testament that Christ and the Father are two different people, although they behave as though they are one person. The Father is the very life of Jesus Christ, just as Christ desires to be our life. Christ shows Himself to us by drawing so close to us that we are conscious of His presence all times. Try looking to Him as much as you can and obey His will with all your might. Delight yourself in the Lord. Rejoice and be glad for each day the Lord provides for you, then see if His presence in your life has increased. I think you will agree that it has. Also, you may find yourself being more aware of the Father as a separate person. Then Judas Iscariot said, "But Lord, why do you intend to show yourself to us and not to the world?" This is the big question, isn't it? Why should there be this special visitation to the disciples prior to the worldwide appearing of the Lord? The answer is as follows. Anyone who loves me will obey my teaching. My Father will love them, and we will come to them and make our home with them. John 14:23. The reward given to those who obey Christ is the coming of the Father and Christ to make their home in that individual. God needs a house, a home, a place of rest, a location for His throne. Man has been created to meet this desire, this need, but only as the individual obeys the teachings of the Lord Jesus. And by the way, God desires and needs a home, not just a house. Do you know the difference? A house is just a cold building. A home is where your loved ones are, and perhaps a family. Okay? God wants a resting place among people who love Him dearly. I wonder if this is the reason for the widespread teaching of grace as an alternative to obeying Christ and God. Is Satan seeking to provoke Christians to disobey Christ? Because he understands that disobedience will prevent the Father and Christ from dwelling in the believer. I will not be surprised if this is the case. A believer can be fervent in their beliefs, but Satan has no fear of a fervent believer. However, Satan is terrified of a Christian who has turned away from their own life and are thinking, speaking, and behaving in concert with the living Lord Jesus. Perhaps this is why our need as Christians is to pray continually for the indwelling of the Father and Christ. The need today is for Christians to mature. The moral standards of our world will not change until the Christians become the moral image of God. It may be true that the work of evangelism will be enhanced when the Christians lead godly lives. Jesus said people will glorify God when they saw our good works. The next three verses are especially important. Okay, that all of them may be, he says, that all of them may be one. Father, just you are in me and I am in you, may they also be in us, so that the world may believe that you have sent me. I have given them the glory that you gave me, that they may be one as we are one, I in them and you in me, so that they may be brought to complete unity. Then the world will know that you sent me and have loved them even as you have loved me. John 17, verses 21 through 23. I believe and think the passage that we have read is saying much the same thing as John 14, verses 18 to 23. It refers to the rest of God, that place in God in which we continuously seek to know His will for that day, a will that was determined at the beginning of the creation. When one ponders the significance of these words of our Lord, it becomes clear that God the Father is enlarging Himself through His children, with our Lord Jesus being the first begotten and the firstborn from the dead. The entire entity includes the Father, the Son, and those who have become part of the Lord Jesus, that is, have become the body of Christ. It is this oneness with everyone partaking of the divine nature that absolutely is sublime when you think about it. It may be true that the developers of the Trinity doctrine, while their objectives were of the highest possible reverence, gave us a confusing picture. Part of that confusion arises from the practice of using the name God as a family name. God is not a name like Tom or Sylvia. God is a title. We do not know what God's family name is or if he even has one. Jesus is a family name, a flesh and blood person like us. To say that Jesus is God does not mean that he is the Father. It refers rather to the exalted authority the Father has assigned to him. So the Father is God, Jesus is God, the Holy Spirit is God. This does not mean they are all are the Father, only that they are of the highest authority. Jesus referred to his Father as my God. Jesus said, "Do not hold on to me, for I have not yet ascended to the Father. Go instead to my brothers and tell them, I am ascending to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God." John 20, verse 17. Let me repeat what I said previously. The entire entity includes the Father, the Son, and those who have become part of the Lord Jesus, that is, part of the body of Christ. It is this oneness with everyone partaking of the divine nature that absolutely is sublime when you think about it. The reason I've been pointing out that the Father and Jesus are separate persons, although one in all they are, one in all they are and do, is that we have been called to be a part of this oneness. The widespread doctrine of the Trinity may, to some people, seem to be so unapproachable that they could not conceive of being part of the glorious oneness. I think people that picture one person in three manifestation or three persons in one Trinity and are comforted and blessed by this belief ought to continue in this point of view. And it all may become clear when they die and go to heaven. However, when the Bible states that Jesus is God's Son, many of us take comfort in this familiar idea. When we realize that Jesus came to bring us to our Father, and we will be able to know the Father as our Dad, we are greatly blessed. Also, the idea of the Lord being our older brother or even our husband, we are familiar with these relationships. All things have been committed to me by the Father, by my Father. No one knows the Son except the Father, and no one knows the Father except the Son, and those to whom the Son chooses to reveal him. Matthew 11, verse 27. The Lord Jesus is the way to the Father, and I believe as we enter the third great platform of redemption, the Father will become much more real to us than has been true in the past. So today, there may be an unprecedented opportunity to know Jesus and the Father and to have them dwelling in us to the point that we can speak with them throughout the day and night. Since the spiritual atmosphere is becoming increasingly dark, this close relationship with the Father and Christ may become necessary if we are to survive and assist our loved ones to survive spiritually. Let me conclude with these scriptures in Romans 8, verses 16 and 17, and John 17, verse 21. You heard me say, I'm going away and I am coming back to you. If you love me, you would be glad that I am going to the Father, for the Father is greater than I. The Spirit Himself testifies with our spirit that we are God's children. Now, if we are children, then we are heirs, heirs of God and co-heirs with Christ, if indeed we share in His sufferings, in order that we may also share in His glory, that all of them may be one, Father, just as you are in me and I am in you. May they also be in us, so that the world may believe that you have sent me. In conclusion, so what God is doing today is the Holy Spirit of God is bringing us to the third platform or the third work of divine redemption, which is the tabernacle experience. Tabernacles is just beginning to be fulfilled in the days in which we are living. Tabernacles is, as its name suggests, has to do with God's plan in creating man. It is the dwelling of God in man and dwelling of man in God. The God of heaven has given us his best in the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, if we are to enter the third work of redemption, we must give God our best. Let us pray. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Lord, for we now know, Lord, as the Spirit gave us insight, what you are doing within us and what you are doing, Lord, today. May we know that, Lord, and ponder and meditate upon it each day. Thank you, Father. Bless your children. In the name of Jesus. Amen. God bless you, saints. See you tomorrow. And God bless.